Transgressive art comes in many forms, all aiming to challenge restrictions and oppose contemporary views. I feel most art always intends to rebel against norms and aims to change and push forward the beliefs of a society. Fashion plays an important role in this. Though a contentious topic in the art world, I believe fashion is most definitely art, filled with just as much expression as a painting or piece of pottery. Especially considering designers like Alexander McQueen, who constantly pushed the boundaries of the fashion world during his career, becoming famed for controversy and shock tactics, he created shows that were more comparable to performance art than a catwalk. I would argue that fashion is one of the most important forms of art in our society, as it holds such importance to our way of life. However, in spite of the fact that classical theorists such as George Simmel developed important theories about fashion and material belongings, sociological studies of fashion and clothing remained underdeveloped today, and the potential of material culture as a medium for cultural change is often ignored. For example, clothing can be a vehicle for socialization and social control, or alternatively, for liberation from cultural constraints. The former is shown by the important roles that uniforms perform in education, religious organisations, and other organisations such as the military. The latter can be seen in the profusion of subcultural clothing styles in the past half a century. For this video essay, I will be focusing on subcultural fashion, in particular punk, as it really shows the transgressive nature of fashion. What better way to break a boundary than to wear it on your body for everyone to see?
This is a public service announcement with guitar! Know your rights! All three of them! Number one, you have the rights not to be killed. Murder is a crime.
Punk is a music genre that emerged somewhere between the 1960s and mid-1970s in the UK and the United States. It rejected the excesses of mainstream rock and instead promoted a DIY ethic, meaning many bands self-produced their records and distributed them through independent record labels. This homemade aesthetic translated into the look of the punk rocker, which typically included short unkempt hair, ripped clothes and dark colours, meant to counteract the look of the 1970s mainstream hippie or disco culture. And speaking to my father about his time growing up as a punk in the UK, he similarly stated that they were drawn towards clothing that was considered the opposite of hippies, such as extremely tight drainpipe trousers, Doc Martens, and simply combining what they already had. The more worn, the better.
Sometimes at the beginning, I used to wear just big, loose, baggy, my dad's old shirts. I didn't have any money. I didn't know where to go and get clothes. And I thought, why should I pay for clothes when if I can just make some stuff at home? If I'd made a pair of trousers, they'd write you, take a picture of me. Because I thought, I'm never going to look like this again. And my parents were appalled at my appearance. They were appalled. And I used to say to them, I'm not going to look like this when I'm 40, am I?
In the UK, the fashion of punk clothing in the late 1970s was largely influenced by designers such as Vivienne Westwood and the Bromley Contingent. Shops on the famed King's Road in London, such as Sex, or Seditionaries as it became renamed, ran by Malcolm McLaren and Vivienne Westwood became very popular. They largely consisted of designs which confronted social and sexual taboos. These included t-shirts bearing the images of the Cambridge rapist's face hood, and semi-naked cowboys from a 1969 illustration by the US artist Jim French.
You could only go to kind of Oxfam shops in Norwich and rip the kind of pockets off, put some safety pins on, have some drain pipes and buy some monkey boots. So, you know, it was the only way to come down to London, and you knew King's Road was the place to come. It was making your journey down the left as usual, So you could go past Boy or Kings Road Markets if anything was in there. And you're making a beeline really for seditionaries.
Malcolm and his girlfriend Vivian's highly original designs formed the basis of the first punk dress.
Accessories seemingly stolen from BDSM fashions such as ripped fishnet stockings, spiked bracelets and necklaces, as well as other jewellery featuring studs or spikes became prevalent. Anything within or without reason could be turned into part of what Vivian Westwood called confrontational dressing, so long as the contrast between natural and constructed context was clearly visible. Objects borrowed from the most sordid of contexts found a place in the punk's ensembles. Lavatory chains were draped in graceful arcs across chests encased in plastic bin liners. Safety pins were taken out of their domestic utility context and worn as gruesome ornaments through the cheek, ear or lip, immortalised by Westwood's God Save the Queen t-shirt, featuring Queen Elizabeth with a safety pin through her nose.
Although trying to emulate it, Westwood's designs were a far cry from the original DIY ethic of punk, as the prices were much too high to be within the reach of the working class youth within the culture. Of course, punk did more than just upset the wardrobe. It encapsulated the socio-economic and political climate of the late 1970s and formed a distinct youth culture that in turn provoked a media-driven moral panic and prompted notable cultural change. Primarily, it politicised cultural practice through the lyrics and iconography, which commented on society and politics, and its approach challenged the prevailing orthodoxies of the music industry. Punk spawned a culture that served as an alternative media source of information and exchange. It questioned social and political hierarchies and notions of personal identity. The style and fashion of the subculture allowed the youth to connect with this ideology, paving the way for self-reinvention and the individuality of the postmodern era. Malcolm McLaren wrote, "I love the way clothes have the power to change the mind that inhabits them. People normally wear uniform to reflect their job or role in life. Fashion, used as a disguise, allows you to be something you're not." The visible stylistic transgressions of punk allowed members of the culture to be identified by the public just from their appearance. The moral panic perpetuated by the media that followed them meant punks were viewed by the public as vile or evil and a threat to society.
It's not bloody music, I don't give it music or not. As far as I'm concerned, we're sitting much longer with the company. If we get a bit up for it, that's bloody hard luck, you know. We're never going to back down.
This is the future, Sasuke!
I want it for my baby,
Sasuke!
You can get up to 50 people in the street and say, "Have you seen the punk rock concert?" And they'll say no. Yeah, they still think it's disgusting. All they've read is in the papers, like the Sunday People.
Hang on, here comes that feeling again. Yes, I dump your mother things all inside. And it used some time to spare. And it's in my hand and turn me there.
I mean, there's people abandoning this, that they're saying that I'm vile and obscene. Do I look vile and obscene?
The last thing I ever wanted was all these kind of really mad punk rockers coming out, appearing all over the place, you know. I mean, the press are down and everybody's down on them. But you talk to them, they're all really nice kids, you know.
It's like
that music's really good.
It's really like a Pandora's box. The whole thing, to a certain extent, has been created out of the media. But, like, it's got out of hand, and the media now don't know what to do with it. They can't cope with it. And unfortunately, because they can't cope, they're screwing up a lot, and they're causing a lot of aggravation.
The image caused by the media led to reactions from the public that were grossly negative, varying from stares, insults or aggressions to the expulsion from public spaces such as cafes. This aggravated the difficulties these young people already felt in finding places where they could enjoy a subcultural experience, and so the sense of belonging they felt from the subculture held even more importance. The punk aesthetic served as an indicator of group membership and as a form of ontological security. Recognising punk accessories served to reinforce group and individual identity in a society that did not welcome them. We must also acknowledge the lasting effect punk has had on fashion and culture. Many punk trends and fashions have been appropriated into mainstream culture. You can buy a Ramones t-shirt, a studded belt and black skinny jeans at any Zara or H&M. And to relate to the start of this video, even high fashion designers like Alexander McQueen have heavily referenced the punk look. Punk fashion may not be so challenging to society today, but it certainly has a lot to answer for.